The aim of the presentation is to claim that an autobiography written in verse is as effective as an autobiography written in prose, and to explain the reasons why an autobiography written in verse can be considered more successful and more contemporary than one written in prose. We begin with Philippe Lejeune, the first to give a definition of this genre with its own characteristics. Then we will move on Menotti Laro's quote, and we add two examples to support it. Let's start. Philippe Lejeune is a French professor and essayist, born on the 30th of August in 1938. In his academic researches, he has always been involved with autobiography, and in 1975 he provided the first definition of this genre through the sale Pact Autobiographique, in which he established the theoretical basis of this genre. The setting is the following. The autobiography is the perspective record in prose that a real person gives of his or her own being, emphasizing the personal life and in particular the story of life. This interpretation indicates for obligation that we must always find in an autobiographical text according to the genre. The first is the obligation of form, that the narration is in prose and in the past. The second obligation is of content, that the narration is of an individual life. Then the third obligation is of morals, that the narration is of stories really lived, that are subject to the fact and to the sincerity. The third obligation is of the author's situation, and so this means that there must be a coincidence between the author, the narrator, and the main character. And the last is the pact of truth. The choice of prose was based on different reasons. First of all, a text written in prose is more effective than one written in a verse, because the first has a lesser extent. By necessity, Lejeune identified with autobiography only the one written in a prose. A second reason is due to the fact that the reader aims at considering the I with a universal self when he reads an autobiographical text written in verse, but the narrator is individual. Furthermore, if we use a prose, we will have an increased clarity in the statement, the plot will be understood by more people, and the reader will make less effort. These last two notions can be summarized as follows. The autobiography written in prose, it's the target in a more direct way than a one written in verse, because of metaphors and events which are left to the imagination, on the contrary of the prose, which tends to explain the feelings and the events in a descriptive and punctual way. In each autobiography, to be such, we have to read the autobiographical pact. This concept was formulated by Lejeune, and in order to create an autobiography, the author enters into a pact or a contract with the readers, promising to give a detailed account of is or a life and of nothing but that life. And so between the reader and the author, there is the pacto of truth, and between them and embryo relationship is created, in which the author asks the reader to believe in him. And so the reader's reaction is encouraged by the same nature. The opposite of the factor of truth is the factor of telling, where the author can write what he wants, not only the truth. And in this case, there is a debraille relationship in which the reader reacts to the text. When the author begins his text with the fact of truth, he clarifies his letter of intention. In 1985, Lejeune republished his essay, and he thinks better of the formal obligation, because the autobiography goes to involve all the resources of the myth and of the poetry. Another example to show more effective of the poetry than of the prose is given by an episode from the Prelude of Wordsworth. She was an Alpinist. Lastly, I dipped my horse into the silent lake. And as I rose up on the stroke, my boat went leaping through the water, like a swan. When from behind that craggy steep, till then the bound of the horizon, a huge cliff, as if with voluntary power instinct, upraided its head. And this episode, it is when the author was in his adolescence and stole a ship situated in the Ulster Lake, where he was spending his holiday. And this episode can be read into different narrative levels of analysis, one explicit and the other one implicit. The last one is determining by overdetermining the emotional value of his emotion as a memory. And in conclusion, this means that with an autobiography written in verse, we can be more effective, and things can have a deeper purpose that we can only understand with an implicit analysis of the text.
In 2012, Enoch Larro published a narrative where self-helps in verse, not in verse in verse, a volume that traces the main critical theories of the autobiographical genre, and in the end it demonstrates that poetry is more effective to narrate an autobiography than prose, contrary to what claims Lejeune. Several reasons are led to state that the most effective method to narrate any autobiography is by using poetry. A clear example is the problem of time. As Taracha says, past life appears to be shrouded in a cloud that blurs time and events. The timing which follows and a chronological order of events is unnatural, because the author keeps on breaking it to insert experiences such as flashbacks, previews, or recaps. Sartre has contributed to the revolution of the biographical narrative and of the traditional structure of the autobiography. In his autobiography, everything happens as bold events were almost contemporary. As Lejeune says, the order of storytelling does not refer to the story of a human being. Since poetry aims at the fragmentation, by using autobiography in verse, the poet may feel less obliged to follow a chronological and linear order of events since his birth. For over a century, both prose and poetry follow the principles of synchrony, of fragmentation, and of the point of view. So this distinction between these two related to the chronological difference does not exist. So one of the constraints that Le Jeune requires in his definition of autobiography, which is narrative narration in a chronological terms of lifetime, today cannot be put in place because narrativity is turning in discourse, as Battistini thought. This is a clear result of a reality which can be understood only in a fragmentary and synchronic way, and which literary genre best expresses fragmentation than poetry. So why we do not use it to write autobiography? Through poetry we can reach the most amazing autobiography and narrative. The criticism almost evenly agrees in saying that poetry is the literary genre best expressive and communicates to readers states of mind, places, and atmosphere that the author wants to narrate. This is what Leopardi wants to point out in his poem Silvia, when with the expression lingua non mortale states the language of poetry, the only one able to tell his own feelings. So given that the poetry is the literary genre that of greatest expressiveness and that it's most effective in telling the reenactment and creation of images compared to prose, then it could also be the most effective in telling the personal life of an individual. In fact, the pluralism of meanings and of images that comes to the mind of the reader seems to take place thanks to the use of verse instead of prose. It has to be said that contemporary poetry is a strongly prosaic poetry, so and it uses mainly free verse. So this is the differences between poetry and prose. As Gabriella Sica says, poetry in a certain period during the 20th century takes the weather rhythm of a prose. Le Jeune, with his book Le Parti Autobiographique, marks a theoretical step with which other critics will need to compare their ideas. An important turning point was marked by new deconstructionist concepts by Hannah Arendt and Adriana Cavallero. They claim that an actual unreliability of any autobiography. Adriana Cavallero, in her book Tu che mi guardi, tu che mi racconti, states that a person can only understand his or her story by listening to it for an external identity. So this identity is the only one who can really get the autobiographical truth of a person. Cavallero brings Ulysses as an example. Ulysses cries to listening to the story of his life told by the blind bard. Ulysses is aware of his life, of his past life, of his action, of his emotion, but according to Cavallero, gets to really understand it them only by listening to it from an external point of view. But it is really true. Maybe not. Maybe Ulysses is crying for other reasons. Maybe he's crying for the moving beauty and the emotion that the story told provokes. But Cavallero, almost unconsciously, came closer to a great truth. In fact, he's the other one who has to tell the biographical story. And this, but this is a crucial point. The other one is still the same person. It's his self who lived in a previous time and of one now another self who wants to write the memories. Significantly in this regard, it's important what Giovanni Storace says. He claims that the one who is narrating and the one who is narrated become two different people. According to him, to be able to write an autobiography is necessary a distance between the self-narrated and the narrating self. So it's we are still ourselves, but our personal self has changed. It's as we are looking at the mirror, but we cannot still recognize ourselves but another self.
In the period between 1950 and 1980, part of the so-called postmodernism, there are no canonical autobiographies written in verse, but we have strong impulses that make possible autobiographies in poetry. In this period, poets take distances from Romanticism, Realism, and Modernism, but they don't deny them. they give importance to the historical context, and they are aware that they need the reconstruction of what was destroyed by the World War II, even if they are aware that the mentality cannot be restored. Actually, only a few poets are able to put turning points in their poetry, because the most of these poets remain focused on the style. And history becomes a sort of playground, and where the past is treated with irony, as if it was something like totally absurd. However, the group known as the Movement is the only one able to distinguish itself, because its poets try to use a clear and raw style without eccentricity, and with a crystal clear style, with bare and distorted images. And they wanted to speak with people with a common language and try to communicate with them. In this movement, the authors try to erase the cultural excess typical of that period. In all this, only one thing keeps on playing a fundamental role, and this thing is the fragmentation. Fragmentation is the only thing that can make the author can make the reader understand what the author wants to say, and the reader can reach in this way the and it's in order to communicate fragment, prose is not sufficient. They need to use poetry, because it is the only literary genre that is useful in order to understand the truth and the fragment. And in this, for this reason, in the postmodernism, we have a lot of examples of autobiographies, poetry. And the two main elements in this poetry are places, both of existence and of memory, and objects that are very important because they can objectify sensations and memories of the poets. Main authors of this period are Seamus Heaney and Tom Gunn, and they are crucial because in their opinions, it's really important the historical context in which they live, and there is a strong civil protest. They write autobiographical poetry, and we have to pay attention and not confuse this autobiographical poetry with the autobiography in verse. The most important example of autobiography in verse is Wordsworth, The Prelude, a divine self-biography born with the intent to tell the truth and the real life of the author. For this reason, there is a declaration of intent and a pact of sincerity with the reader, and because the author wants to tell only his real life. For this reason, we have no fantastic narration, and this is the most of realistic points. And Wordsworth use objects and places because they are the only one that are able to aware the dormant parts of an autobiography. Also, Heaney and Gunn use places and objects in their literary production, but they are different because they write autobiographical poems. In fact, they don't do any declaration of intent. They don't do a pact with the reader because they don't express the will of writing an autobiographical poetry. They don't want to tell his life, and so the truth isn't guaranteed. Heaney, in his collection of verses, wants to recollect his identity through splinters of memory, but these splinters do not guarantee the truth. He wants to he wants to tell not his own life, but he wants to use his autobiography in order to express his will of a civil protest for a free Ireland. And for this reason, he uses objects and places of his existence in order to reconstruct the identity of the Irish nation. Gunn instead expresses his cry of pain because he is oppressed by prejudice of a society that is still too closed to accept his homosexuality. And he feels the need to write autobiography because he wants to preserve what we fear could be erased from our memory. And he decides to write autobiography even if he is aware that if there is the possibility of distortion of what he said, and he does not guarantee the truth of what he says. For this reason, he doesn't do an impact of truth with the reader, and indeed, he makes clear that this type of text can find a big risk of muddling poetry. So, Ini and Gunn write autobiography poems, and being aware that this is the real only literary genre that can express fragmentation, but they are also aware that they cannot ensure truthfulness as Wordsworth did.
Just coming back to the goal of our presentation, contrary to what Mr. Lejeune claims in the first version of his autobiographical pact, poetry is very efficient for narrating emotions and deeper feelings, and it could be even more efficient than prose because of his powerful sensations, which are recreated in the reader with more intensity. So poetry is helped by the deeper intensity which leads the contents to a universal level. And as said before, poetry is the only tool which can grasp the fragmentation. And many authors in the past decided to write their narrations, their thoughts, choosing poetry, even if they didn't want to produce a proper autobiography in verse. And that was the case of Cinosini and of Tom Gunn, who wrote many autobiographical poems instead of a proper autobiography. So I choose a poem from Tom Gunn called Baby Song, just to compare the original version in poetry and a free reinterpretation in prose. So the original is, from the private ease of Mother's womb, I fell into the lighted room. Why don't they simply put me back where it is warm and wet and black? Whereas on the right-hand side, we have the prose version, which is, I came into this world against my will, so I regret the time where I was in my mother's womb, because in there I was away from all my worries. Anyway, the meaning is still powerful because we understand the deep loneliness of the narrator. But do you agree with me if I say that the original version is maybe more delicate and magical? There is something like a power inside poetry that cannot be explained by prose. And this power of poetry was already known in the ancient times, especially during ancient Greek period. And many philosophers stated the supremacy of poetry compared to prose, especially Aristotle, who lived in the 4th century before Christ, so a quite long time ago. he just stated the difference between historiography and poetry. Historiography is just the narration in prose, we can say, of real events staked to a specific period of time, so a specific group of people. And it shows particular things, whereas it's completely the opposite in poetry, because poetry never loses its deep meaning, and it's just travels with centuries, and it's not related to a specific century or to a specific battle, but it's universal. And now let's see just the difference between autobiography in verse and in prose. What's the biggest difference? Basically, the autobiography in verse has a dual nature, so it means that it's both personal and universal, because there is always a narrator in poetry, but it's not so much as much perceived as in prose. So this lack of perception leads the whole content to a universal level. And an autobiography in verse, to be considered as that, must have this dual nature. Whereas for an autobiography in prose, it's not the case, because it's more sticked to the narrator, so it's more personal. So we can say that it has a single nature compared to the autobiography in verse. But it can also aspire to universality, even if it's not an obligation. So an author can always choose how to narrate himself, herself. But if he or she wants to write in verse, his or her autobiography, they must aspire to raise their own story to a universal level. So they cannot just limit themselves to the simple narration of facts, how it happens with prose. But they are free to choose whatever they like the most. So if they think that their stories are not eligible to a universal meaning, they can just choose prose. And as my colleague said before, many authors in the past decided to narrate themselves in verse because they knew the power of poetry, and they knew that they felt that it was the best way to explain themselves. For example, Giacomo Leopardi, he said, well, just stated that only the universal language of poetry could have given justice to his feelings and to his beloved Silvia, as everyone knows. And I would like to think about the most successful authors that everyone of us knows about, such as Leopardi, Montale, or even Shakespeare and Dante Alighieri. They wrote a lot of poems. They chose poetry. And nowadays, we are still studying their poems at high school, at university. And I would like just to think about the possibility if their poems were written in prose. How would they sound? Do you think the message would be the same? Do you think the feelings would be the same if they were written in prose? So probably, we will never know that, but probably they will sound great anyway, because these authors were geniuses of literature. But surely their writings wouldn't be so memorable and so mesmerizing as they sound in poetry. And just to conclude, if an author or everyone else wants to narrate himself, herself, and immortalize their story, their feelings throughout the centuries, they should just reconsider using poetry to do that, because it's the best tool for achieving this goal. Thank you very much.